Hey, Digilogue fam, welcome back to Artists to Watch. Today, we are sitting down with California-based singer-songwriter Reggie Becton. Thanks for joining us today, Reggie.
What's happening, everybody?
Hey, so I should really say welcome back, because a lot of people in our community may recognize you from our Artists to Watch series. You did a performance, and we had you as a featured artist for that week. What was that experience like for you?
It was amazing, you know. Big love and shout out to the Digilogue team. It's been great working with you guys, and you guys have been super supportive. So that session we had recorded in the actual studio that where we were working on the album last summer. We were doing some recording sessions there, some long days trying to get some production up for the album. And in between that, I have a drop Listening, which was a song that did really well. So we had taped this live session in the studio one of the times we were locked in there. And we got that done and it came out really well, super clean. And that's still the only place we've posted that one. So it was like this own little time warp of speed. So it was special for the Digilogue community and I really enjoyed that.
For sure. And I know that's kind of like the trends, you know, obviously during COVID is just doing those live performances.
Right.
But, you know, we're glad we got a little exclusive set from you. And that resonated with the community really well and people love you. So it was awesome to be able to share that. I wanted to give everyone a little bit of context as to, you know, your background. You were raised in PG County, Maryland.
Yes.
You went to Temple, which is out in Philly, and you're currently now based in California.
Right.
So those are all very major cultural hubs. What impacts have each of those cities had on you?
I think starting like in my hometown, you know, PG County, Maryland is right outside of DC, which is like the home, and the sound there is go-go, which is like this fusion of like rock, jazz, hip hop, soul music. It's like all these things in one. And I think that really like allowed me, like listening to go-go and growing up on those things like that, I think that really allowed me to have like this ear for music that's not necessarily deemed in one genre. I'm a big fan of like rock and roll, big fan of R&B and hip hop and different things like that. It's, you know, I listen to music and I'm more of a fan of sounds than I am as in like genres. There's certain sounds I'm like, really, I love that sound. So that's, I think, something that go-go allowed me to do. And yeah, I was just telling somebody the other day about Philly, where like Philly, you have this home of like neo soul with like Erykah Badu and D'Angelo, and where they like just found music soul child, where they really just honed in on this style of neo soul, which is still very present in Philly. And also Philly has a great like poet and poetry based there. So in college there was this organization at my school that was called Babel, and they were a poetry organization filled with all these wonderful, amazing poets. And just listening to them kind of, I think, like really helped me to like dive deeper in like lyrics and like songwriting and things of that nature, and also just ground myself and immerse myself more in the genre of R&B and neo soul, which I think kind of now you hear more present in my sound.
Yeah. And go ahead.
No, and then Cali, I just think Cali has made me a bit more like mood music. I don't know, like anytime I hear music, I'm always thinking like, this sounds good on a nice drive to Cali and things like that. I also think that like, since moving out here, my music has become a lot more guitar driven. I've been practicing playing guitar, but I just really love the instrument of the guitar, and building songs around the guitar is something that I really enjoy doing. So that's kind of what I've been picking up for all these three places.
Yeah, and it's a nice medley of different inspirations to have. And being surrounded by music pretty much, you know, from when you were in PG County, at what moment was that like that pivotal moment for you where everything just kind of clicked and you realized, all right, music is what I got to do? Or was that something that you kind of just grew into?
I think it was like I grew into it, but at the same time, I remember when I was about like when I was going off to college to go to Temple and things like that, I remember I was like had got this opportunity to work with like an indie label that was in DC as a songwriter, things like that. So when that happened, I kind of felt like, and that happened based on one of the like A&Rs or label heads there had heard a song that I written from a family friend. A family friend had heard a song I written, and then they sent it to a person at that label and they really enjoyed it. And I was like, damn, if this one song could kind of get me in the door of this label, if I just keep at this thing and keep practicing and working hard on my craft, then, you know, like the world would be mine. And then after I graduated college, it was like, all right, either you're going to start on this career track or you're going to really give this music thing a shot, you know, and really take it seriously. And that's when I kind of like made the decision to move to California. And ever since then, it's just been like on the ground running.
Yeah. And that's so important. Like having somebody that is aware of what you're doing and willing to share that. And if they see other opportunities, willing to put you on, that is so crucial. But also being able to, you know, bet on yourself and be like, you know what, I got to go for it. Let me just, you know, get up out of here and try something different.
Yeah, I feel like they go hand in hand. Like people will bet on you once you start betting on yourself. You know what I mean? Once you take those first steps to better yourself, it may not be your best friend. It may need to be the people you think will bet on you, but there will be someone who'll see you doing something or hear something you're doing. And that'll be the person to bet on you. And those are the people you want to keep around.
Exactly. Yeah, you never know who's watching. So like you said, got to stay ready. So whenever the opportunity comes, you can just seize it. But you know, now that you're in California, obviously moving across the country to pursue your dream is not an easy feat by any means. I feel like sometimes we get so caught up in like, you know, when you're following someone on Instagram or like seeing all the great things that they're doing, that you don't really realize like all the sacrifice and everything that it took to get there. So what made you decide that you wanted to move to LA, and what was that experience initially like for you when you were first starting out?
Yeah, I think like going back to like, to me, what the ultimate decision came from like finally saying, okay, I know that like I'm pretty good at this music thing, and for some reason I can't seem to shake it. You know, like as a kid, like I started out making music with like my family and my cousins, you know, and like everybody's dream is to be on a stage when they're little and things like that.
Yeah.
And as the years progress, like, or with friends, you know, as the years progress, like one of my friends would be like, yeah, this isn't really for me no more. We're in seventh grade. They like go on to do different things. And then you lose a friend in ninth grade who's not really interested. And then you lose a friend in like 10th grade. And for some reason, it just never, the passion for music, for creating music, that bug just never went away for me. So as all these people kind of like dropped to the wayside and started to move on and do different things with their career, I was still sitting here like, I kind of still
want what I want to do. Yeah.
And I don't really know how I can get this done. And a friend of mine who I was really close with in college, he wanted to move to LA too. And we was like, yo, we should just move there as well. So we both copped a one-way ticket. We had saved a little bit of money. I had about maybe what, $800 here. When I first got on the plane to get to LA, I didn't even have a place to stay for the weekend. We had booked this Airbnb for a month long. But that we came to California on a Friday and the Airbnb reservation didn't start till Monday.
Mm-hmm.
So we're like scrambling on the plane and like buying Wi-Fi that the plane had. And we finally found a place, which was cool. But my first year of living in California, I stayed in Airbnbs like my whole entire first year. I didn't have a house. I was just Airbnb month to month, sometimes week to week, you know, just trying to find my foot in, trying to find a job and find ways to make income. It was a point where I think the final 6 months, it was me, my friend who I moved out here with, and then another friend of ours who had moved from Temple that we kind of knew. We all were staying in like this one bedroom, hotel room kind of, if you want to say. And when you hear hotel, you think fancy, but this was really this like a rectangular space with two twin beds in it.
Yeah.
And we bought an air mattress, and it had a window AC unit, so thank God about that. And we would, every week we would like rotate beds. So like we all would rotate the air mattress so we all get a fair chance. And we just lived out our suitcases for like for those remaining months. And then finally, like the next year, I was able to get an apartment.
Wow.
It's just been progressing since then.
Yeah. And that's important to keep that perspective, because I think a lot of people like starting out, sometimes you want it the easy way, or you don't realize like the sacrifices that you have to put to get to where you have to be. So it's great to be able to like, you know, hear your story and see where you are now and where you were when you started is completely night and day. So that's interesting to hear. Are those still people that you are friends with and are close to you? Or are you still living with them?
Yeah, I'm the friend I moved out here with that like I originally moved out here with. We're still super close. We still live together. The other friend that we had like around that time, we don't talk as much, but you know.
Yeah. Different paths. Everybody moves on, but it's nice that you still have, you know, your friend that you were day one with. So that's awesome.
Day one is still there.
Yeah. So I think it's, you know, only fair to take a moment to address the orange beanie.
Okay.
I was reading your interview with, I think it was with Black and Gifted, and you mentioned how like the orange beanie came to be. And I think that was really an important lesson in like personal branding. Because personally to me, I thought, you know, it was a nod to Marvin Gaye because there's like that iconic picture of him wearing the orange beanie. So can you tell us how all of that came to be?
Yeah. So, I used to work downtown in LA, and I will, every time on my lunch breaks or anything, I would just go walk around the city and kind of like look at the different stores and things. And in this particular store, there was a store like called Tanger Leather or something, but they, I would always go in there because they have really nice, like, pieces and really nice garments and things like that. And on this particular day, I walked in there and they had these beanies. They had like these different color beanies, and this orange one just stuck out to me. So I copped the beanie that day, and I just had copped it just to, like, you know, I go back east sometimes. I was like, okay, I'll wear it. You know, I still experience winter there. And I started making these cover videos. And also when I purchased the beanie, of course, that iconic image of Marvin Gaye was there. So I'm like, okay, this would be cool too. Like, you know, I love Marvin Gaye. You know, like, it'll be cool. But I started wearing this, I started a cover video, and it was The Weeknd by SZA, and I uploaded that one, and it kind of did a lot of like good numbers, kind of had this like little viral moment. So after that, I like did another one, and I had the beanie on again, and then I did another one. I was like, okay, I'm just gonna keep putting this beanie on so I become more recognizable. When people see that, be like, okay, this is the same guy. This is the same guy. And I hate having to, like, a lot of people will put their like social media tags or username on there. And I think that's very important, but I don't like that because I hate how it looks and like ruin the aesthetic of something. So yeah. I was like, if they see the orange beanie, they'll know it's the same guy that's been singing in this orange beanie. But after that, I did a show. It's like my first show in LA. And when I was coming off the stage, all of my friends like hyped me up, saying how amazing it was, things like that, as friends do. And one of my friends was like, yo, when the orange beanie is on, like, it's, you know, it's game time. Like, it's, you know, playing, like, here comes the orange beanie.
Yeah.
And that's when it kind of clicked to me, like, okay, this is a thing, you know, like,
this is me. Thing,
and I can use this to kind of like, kind of brand myself. And it's also something that like has personal ties to me because of the Marvin Gaye reference that many people would think about when they see the orange beanie, and him being from Washington, D.C., which is like really close to PG County, Maryland, and it's where I like grew up at, and I went to high school and things like that. And so it was like all these things in one that kind of like made this perfect melting pot and synergy to like make this orange beanie like become this staple in my brand.
Yeah, now it's synonymous with Reggie. You see the orange beanie and you already know who it is.
Yeah, people keep telling me I need to start selling them, but I just really love the quality of this one. So it's made by a company named Bricks and Wood. They're a Black-owned business from South Central LA, I believe. And they have these beanies. I think they just restocked the orange ones. So if you want an orange beanie, check out Bricks and Wood.
Exactly. We need the affiliate link. We need the collab.
Yeah, I'm waiting on a collab. I would love to collab with them. They're so dope.
No, that's awesome. And it's super important to support Black business. So that's good to know also. On the topic of the orange beanie, you released My Beanie's Orange back in 2019. And you featured the single Raining in LA. And you know, we've heard time and time again, like R&B is dead. People aren't like crying out for their woman anymore. And you really took that personally because you were out here singing in the rain.
Yeah.
So how important is that authentic, like very raw and honest traditional R&B sound to you?
I think for me, it's like super important. I'm a big fan of like history and lineage and like just honoring those that came before you and like learning from them and things like that. So like I love Avant, I love Tank, I love Brandy. Like those are some of my favorite singers. And so anytime I'm like making a music video or something like that, I'm always thinking like, how can I like pay homage to someone who really inspired me or who just gave so much to the genre? Because making art isn't an easy thing. Like you give a lot of your personal life and your personal stories and your personal feelings on these songs. And I think that any artists out here doing that, they deserve some type of respect. They deserve their flowers.
For sure.
So I think that's part of it. And then I think with R&B music, it's all about like the soul and the vulnerability that you can exhibit and you can try to like make someone else. To me, it's all about like giving someone a soundtrack to their pain, the same pain that I once needed. So it's like being that voice that I needed that got me through. I don't want you to have to go write a song about it. Just listen to this and
hopefully
it helps you, you know, like ease that tension. But I just think that's super important in like R&B music to have that expression and that honesty, which we don't hear very often enough. And I think that I hate R&B is dead, but they used to say the same thing about hip hop and
exactly.
Now nobody says that anymore. So normally people are saying that when the genre is about to make get re-energized.
Like a rebirth.
Yeah, it's becoming a rebirth. We're probably like in this like renaissance period right now. And I think that there's amazing people out here making R&B. you just have to, one, know what R&B is, and then go find that.
Yeah, 100%. I also hate when people say that, because it's just like, if you're looking for R&B like that on the radio, you're probably not going to find it, but that doesn't mean that it's dead. There are definitely still people putting out that type of music and still having like that very raw, vulnerable sound. So it was just great to see that. And I just thought that was a cool detail, because I was like, yo, this man is really out here just singing in the rain.
A response to everything on social media, singing in the rain, the song, like begging and pleading, that type thing. Like I'm a big like Twitter and Instagram guy, so I'm always like looking to see what people are saying about R&B and different things. So that definitely provides some inspiration for me when I'm in the studio.
For sure. Stay tapped in. Give the people what they want.
Right.
So fast forward to your most recent project, which was a 5-track EP called Thanks for Listening. And you released that back in December of last year. We were, you know, well into the pandemic at that point. Everything was a little bit crazy. What was the overall inspiration behind that project specifically, and kind of what was going on in your life leading up to that release?
Honestly, it was, I wouldn't say there was a big, that project was just inspired by like the success of like Listening and the success of like the Ghost, those two singles being well received. And we had, I think we had really intended, honestly, to like put the album out last year that we're working on now. We've been working on it for quite some time. And I think when the pandemic hit, you know, that kind of like just shifted our schedules and things. And then we had the pandemic and we had some singles ready, and those didn't come out as we thought was going to happen. There were a couple of features and collaborations that just didn't happen. So then we kept pushing the schedule back and the release date because of all these things that were going on in the world. And we just felt like people weren't ready to really receive the type of music that I was making. Music, you know, just like, you know, like we were all in a weird space, of course. So Listening came about like after just like being in sessions with different artists, and like really last year I got to like work with a lot of my friends, and because we had so much free time now in our hands that we could just link up and like make music and things like that, it was so much easier, and all of us were kind of like grounded to not go anywhere. And Listening came out of that, and then after that it was Ghost that came like out of that. You know, everybody was at home, so it was easier to like call someone and say, hey, listen to this song, do you mind hopping on it? And Grace Webber, she did Ghost with me, who has an amazing voice. Yeah. And after that one came out and people started to like really gravitate toward that one, I was like, hey, like, you know, we're having a pretty good year, we're getting a lot of looks and great nods and things like that, why not just throw out these songs that we love that aren't going on the album, and, you know, just thank people for listening to the music this year, because it's been such a rough year, you know, with everything that's been going on with like social injustice and things like that, that it was just, I was just excited for people to still be listening to my music through all that was going on in the world. So that was the biggest inspiration behind that.
Yeah. Nice. It's kind of like just a thank you letter for the fans and, you know, through some more stuff to keep you engaged while the world is just going through it. Mm-hmm. But the single from that project, Listening, how you were talking about it, it's a very honest rendition of a toxic relationship, which I think is something that everyone can relate to or has experienced or heard about at some point. And I know songwriting is like one of your, you know, bigger skills. When you songwrite, is it usually always from personal experience, or do you draw from like inspiration from other people, whether it be your friends or stories that you've heard about?
Yeah, it's literally all of that, all the above on that. I think for a long time I focused on drawing inspiration from like my friends and family heavily, just because I don't think I was ready to like let one of my exes or a girl that I've dated or something hear a song that could possibly be about her or something. I wasn't ready for those calls or those texts like, this is about me or something. So I used to heavily lean on like, okay, my brother said this, yada yada yada. But Listening was so dope because I feel like the week maybe, or even maybe 2 days before I wrote it, me and my roommate was having a conversation with another one of our friends. And we were just talking about like love in general, and like we were talking about what's toxic and what's not. And me and my friend at the time were just saying, like, you know, like, love is great, but you need that, like, 5%, that, like, that 2% of toxic, you just need that to keep things interesting. And it's crazy to say because so many people think like this, but that's where, like, the line of, like, what's love if it ain't toxic comes from, you know? But, yeah, it was all about, like, just, like, trying to paint a very real portrayal of, like, what dating is like for millennials right now. Like, we watch so many shows, like, Love and Hip Hop and these reality shows where they, like, paint this love of, like, tormenting and like yeah this, and it's like at times you you feel like you need that in order to like think that someone cares about you and things like that, when really that's not love at all. Like, that's the most toxic shit ever.
Yeah, no, it's definitely intense. And like I said, I think anybody can relate to that at some degree. Obviously, different people have different degrees of toxicity in their relationships, but definitely kind of like a universal theme. But aside from music, like, what are some of the things that inspire you as an artist, whether it be books or movies?
Yeah, I'm a heavy avid of movies. I love movies. I watch a lot of movies. We're always having some type of movie night at my house. I watch a lot of TV shows too. So sometimes those inspire me, especially when I watch like things like The Great Gatsby or stuff like those time period pieces that's about like these monumental figures in history and things like that. Those inspire me a lot. I read novels every now and then, books and things like that. I'm a big fan of like self-help books. Mm-hmm. Anything that's like going to allow me to like think differently or give me a new outlook or way of living, I really enjoy that. And I think like, you know, like everyday life inspires me. So like fashion inspires me, style, really everything. Yeah, just everything.
It's important to just have like just multiple sources of inspiration, that way you don't like, kind of get stagnant.
It's literally being able to like be inspired by maybe a chair. Like the other day I was in the studio with some amazing producers and we were just working on the track, and literally the studio had a window, and it was the outside of the window was this tree. And I love recording with like windows and being able to look out. And I wrote a song, and the song is called Leaves, and it was literally just inspired by how the leaves was like blowing at that time. And granted, the song is not about this tree blowing in the wind, but it gave me the inspiration, like that imagery of the tree blowing in the wind with the leaves gave me the imagery to be able to write this song.
Yeah. And
translate that to maybe a love song or something.
For sure. Yeah, you got to draw inspiration from anywhere. You've previously touched on, you know, how you've been growing as an artist and focusing on developing your sound. Aside from artists that you grew up admiring, like you mentioned before, have there been any current artists that you admire that have had an impact on your sound?
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of Miguel.
Mm-hmm.
I think his voice is amazing. He's just great at songwriting as well. He doesn't get enough credit as a songwriter. Big fan of her. PJ Morton are also some artists that I really look up to, that just as far as music. Jasmine Sullivan, like just lately, yeah, she's been killing it, and been a huge fan of hers, and now I'm even more a fan of hers. And let me think, who else I feel is really good right now? Mike Ayers is good. Love his sound. Such an
amazing. Just a little different too, but
right, you know, it's still different. But oh, and I love Jameson, JMSN. If you haven't heard of him, he's amazing. But those are really a lot of people that inspire me to like make music and things like that, that I really like listen to, and I'm like, damn, I wanna do something like that. I also really enjoy Saba. He's another guy that
I love. Saba.
Really, and I'm listening to like, damn, how are you writing this shit?
Yeah. No, it's super important. Like I said, obviously you have like the iconic people that you look up to your entire life, but it's really important to keep an eye out on what your peers are doing too and draw inspiration from that. Cause I think people are doing really interesting things in music right now. So just being able to just constantly stay inspired through innovation that people are currently doing right now is also super important. But that's a great list of people. A lot of really great vocalists and songwriters in there.
Yeah, they're amazing.
So you've managed to stay busy throughout the pandemic. You did a ton of online shows. Obviously, we had you for our Artist to Watch series. You did Roots Picnic. You had that Home 2 performance. You did R&B Uncut. There were so many, like, honestly, yeah, a lot.
Now that you're listening, I'm like, damn, like,
you know, you did a lot.
I was talking with my manager, and I'm just saying, like, yo, we were talking about like something that happened. I'm like, honestly, the only reason I remember dates is just by release date. So I'm like, I put this project out this year, so that couldn't have happened this year. You know, the projects allow me to give me some time span of life. Like, okay, this happened in 2018, which means that had to happen that same year.
Yeah. No, you were busy. So what has been your favorite experience within the past year, and what do you hope to accomplish within the coming year?
I really enjoyed working on all of them. Like working on the Digilogue one, of course, was so fun because we did it in the middle of working on the album, which was gave us a cool ear break. And also we did it for Listen. That was like the first thing we have a film live performance for. Mm-hmm. Listen, that was cool to like strip it back and hear it in the studio. I really enjoyed the Roots Picnic one as well, because that was the first time I got to like perform all like the new songs off the new EP. So that one was really fun. and we like arrange things very differently. They all have their like quirky things about them. So like the R&B Radar one, we did that on the last day of shooting the listening video. And the listening was a 5-day shoot. So it was a 2-day build out. We like built the set, built the makeshift rooms, and then we did 2 days of recording. And on the breakdown day, we filmed this live set. So it was like a nonstop 5 days for me. And I think that was cool because it really just showed us like this work hard ethic. And also between those 5 days, I had a show for University, CSUN, California State University, Northridge.
Oh, wow.
I had a show for them. So we were like building the set, and then me and my guitarist went into one of the side rooms, did the show on like Instagram Live, and then right after we went right back to building the set. So that was just fun to like, it was a lot of work and I was definitely tired, but it was fun to get a glimpse on like, glimpse of what the future could be like soon.
For sure. And you have to like seize all the opportunities you have available, right? So if you already have like the set, it's like, all right, well, let's film something here. What else can we do? And obviously the importance of having your team behind you that is available to do all these things too is huge.
Exactly. And even with the Roots Picnic, like we got the message about it on like a Monday and we had to have the full video in by that Friday. So like,
oh my God.
That's the team, because they pulled it together in about 2 days. Like the day we got the call, we started working on the live instrumentation and arrangement for it. And we started taking calls about the creative for it, how it would look and things like that. Literally the night before we were told to go to taping, we didn't even have a place to shoot it. And then the day of, we finally found a place and we got it shot and it came out amazing, but that was a rough one.
Yeah, well, you got it done. And again, that's a testament to the people in your corner and the team that you have behind you. So amazing. That's exciting. What do you have upcoming within this year? Do you have an album in the works? What can we expect?
Yeah, so this year we plan to release the debut album, which is super exciting. I'm super excited about the music that's on the project. I think it's elevated sound, and just like I was saying earlier, like it's some of my most personal music that I've made, and I knew that when I was creating this project, I really wanted to come off vulnerable and really bring people into my world and show them my experience about how I deal with love and how I deal with life in general. And the project's called California, and I think it's so cool of a project because the first track is like reminiscent of how I felt moving here back in 2016, getting on that plane. And then last track is kind of like where I am now today. So you go on this kind of like journey with me. And like, at first you hear me like working on myself and trying to like figure out all these things. And then like halfway through, you start to talk about love and get my like experience dealing with love and things like that. And then finally we kind of like wrap a bow and just wrap it all out.
That's exciting. Well, it's kind of like how we've covered today, which is what, you know, starting at the beginning from where you came and then now it's just to the point where you are right now. So I'm sure it'll be a really wonderful journey to go through. Your past projects have been a little bit on the shorter side, you know, usually like 5 or 6 songs. What can we expect from this one?
This one is going to be more than 10.
Okay.
So
that's exciting.
Yeah. It's scary sometimes looking at the track listing and seeing so many songs, but I definitely knew I wanted to like, you know, do something that was feel more fuller and felt a bit longer and more where I could get really like create this sound and like really experiment as well and like be able to like have this long format project. And I just think it's time, you know, I did three years. So I feel like this one, like that trinity is done, like that trinity of EPs is done. And I think now it's time to like just do something more weighted for the fans,
right,
supporters.
For sure. Well, we're excited for that. Obviously, now vaccines are out, people are starting to go outside.
Yeah.
Do you have a tour in the works? Is that something that you guys are planning for? Any live shows coming up?
We are definitely planning for a few live shows. I think we're probably going to do a digital one soon, you know, because things are still a digital one, but I'm excited about that one. Still waiting, final word on that. And I know we'll do Home 3 this year. So that's always going to, maybe that'll be in person. The first one was in person. The second one was digital. So we still don't know. Still, that'll be in the fall though. But no, most definitely hoping for some live opportunities, hoping to like go on tour with artists that I love and just give them some support and like reach some new fans that way in the fall and be able to promote this project as much as possible.
For sure. And do you have a timeline for when you're planning to release it?
The single is due out in this summer. So the first single will come out this summer, hopefully in June. And then the full project will be out in the fall.
Got it. Well, we're excited to listen to it. Definitely excited for all the things that you have coming up in the future.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to tell everybody else where they can stream your music and get to know you a little bit more.
Sure. It's Reggie Becton. You can get to know me on social media. It's Instagram, Twitter, any social media you can think of. I'm pretty sure I'm on it, and I'm pretty sure my name is Reggie Becton on it. And then you want to listen to any of my music, Apple Music, Spotify, any digital streaming platform you could think of, I'm pretty sure I'm on it, and it's Reggie Becton as well.
Perfect. All right, everybody, y'all make sure you check it out. Definitely a lot of great things, a lot of great music videos, so make sure you check out his YouTube as well, because yeah, your team went crazy on those videos. Thank you so much for your time, Reggie. We appreciate it. You know, you're always welcome here with the Digilogue team, and we're looking forward to seeing what you have coming up this year.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
See you later.